Amen.
All throughout the years, God cares for us and has been providing for us and shall continue to supply our needs. He is our Jehovah Jireh. Amen. Let's celebrate as we sing these songs. One. Worship. Let's sing this melody as a declaration of his worthiness as the Lamb of God.
Proud you.
Seated on the throne.
And God's omnipresence through the Holy Spirit assures us that He will be walking with us.
Amen.
Not just this year, but for the rest of the years. Amen. Indeed, He is our Emmanuel. God with us. He has done for us in the year 2022. So I have a list here. Forgive me if I missed some things. It was a year where we started to meet face to face. After 3 years of meeting virtually. Amen. It was also the year where the singles was able to do a face to face retreat. Amen, singles. And of course, the marriage as well. Amen, marriage. It was also last year that the youth ministry lead our worship service twice. First virtually, the second time was here a couple of months back. So we also shared the joy of witnessing Taret and her husband Peter in the church last year. Amen. And last year we also have witnessed some baptisms like Michael's and Sherwin's as well. And who else was baptized last year? Sheena as well. Sheena. 21. Amen. So we also had babies being born, like Hope, the daughter of Miguel and Liza. And we also had Isabella, the daughter of Dudes and all that. And then so many other miracles and blessings that I'm sure each one of us can testify. Amen. Last year might have been quite a challenging year for some of us, but let's give God the glory for allowing us, for seeing us through.
Amen.
You know, for allowing us to see another year, for allowing us to live, you know, another year, another season, another chapter in our lives.
Amen.
And that is because of His faithfulness.
Amen.
And we can read in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 to 24, it says here, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For His compassions never fail. They are new every morning.
Amen.
Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for Him.
Amen.
Amen. Because of God's great love, whatever happened last year has not consumed us. You know, for His mercies and compassion and faithfulness never fail. They are new every morning. That's what the Bible says. And because these are our portion, these are inheritance, we will continue to wait for Him and put our trust in Him.
Amen.
Basically, that's what we need to do for the rest of the year and the years to come, to faithfully put our trust in Him and to wait for our Almighty God. Amen. The sound that we call in my better half.
I'll take that. So indeed, God is a trustworthy God, and His promises are perfect and true. And we don't actually need to wait for another year to unfold to see and experience a new beginning. Because just like what the Lamentations, that verse in Lamentations said, that His mercies, His compassion, His love, His faithfulness are new every morning.
Amen.
Praise God that we can wake up each day resting in God and in His promises, that whatever happened yesterday, last week, last month, and the previous years have all been forgiven, have all been redeemed by a merciful God. And that's all made possible because we're serving a God who does not change. I mean, He brings good changes in us, but He Himself do not change. Now in Hebrews 13 verse 8, it says there, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You know, that the love He has for us since the beginning of time, through to the time that He was hanging on the cross, through today, and even up until forever, till we get to spend the rest of our eternity with Him, will never change. His love will never decrease nor increase, because His love has always been complete and full. To so to say, Jesus loves me more today than yesterday is not true, because His love for us has always been 100%. All the time. And that is our prayer and our hope, that we get to remember this truth for not just for the rest of the 2023, but for the years to come. Happy New Year, everyone.
Amen. We have a wonderful lineup today. We have Nash and Marcel to give us a communion message.
Amen.
We will have Jacob for the sermon. Amen. And then Gary and Arlene for the response and announcements. At this point, we want to welcome our friends who are visiting us today. We have friends who regularly join us every Sunday. Welcome. And to those of you who are joining us for the first time, a huge welcome to you guys. Of course, we want to welcome as well our brothers and sisters from Abu Dhabi, from Sharjah, from Al Ain. If you guys are here, welcome. And of course, from Dubai. And now, I have Elise here as well. We have a family of disciples from Jacksonville Church of Christ. We have William, Diana, and Clarissa, Monica. Welcome. We have Nareg from Lebanon. Welcome, Nareg. Archie and Geraldine's kids, which are Matthew, Maria, Jamie, Joanna. Did I get them right? Oh, welcome, Sally. We have also a brother from Goa, Aaron. Welcome, bro. Amen. So we want to welcome you to the first Sunday worship service. 2023 of ICOC UAE. Amen.
O holy and righteous Father, we come before you today as a family, celebrating not just the new year, but celebrating you who makes all things new. We are here to raise to you our thanksgiving and our praises, for you alone is worthy. As we come to bless your name, may you also bless each and every single heart who came to worship you and seek for you. Let the blood of Jesus take away our guilt and shame so we can approach you and worship you boldly and purely. May our songs of praises resound not just in the four corners of this room, but most importantly, in your throne in heaven, where our Lord Jesus Christ is seated beside you. Let our hearts and spirit be attuned with yours, and may you find this worship service acceptable before you, Lord. To you alone be all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen.
It's by God's power that I'm given a chance to share about the cross. Amen. Turn with me in the Bible to Mark 9 and Hebrews 12. So I titled the song, the communion for me, The Wonders of the Cross. I appreciate the song, and thank you very much, song leaders, for that wonderful song. Brothers and sisters, as we take communion this evening, may we never lose the wonder of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross on Calvary. Communion should never become a ritual act, but every time we partake of the bread and the wine, we are remembering the body of Christ that was broken and the blood of Christ that was spilled on the cross and as an atonement for the sins of this world. In Mark 9:15 says, as soon as all the people saw Jesus, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. This should be the same response for us as we partake of the communion this evening. May we be overwhelmed with wonder as we gaze upon the cross. Amen. It is a wonder because what we see is the creator of all things, the creator of the star, the creator of all heaven, the ocean, the mountains, the creator of all living things, dying for his creation, dying for everything he formed and created. This is an amazing act of love and sacrifice. You know, Hebrews 12:2 says, look to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sitting at the right hand of the throne of God. There are two things that happens when we gaze upon the wonder of the cross. First, we see his saving sacrifice. And secondly, we see his shining example. Let's look at the saving sacrifice. You know, the cross upon which Jesus died is the ultimate hope for mankind because it represents Christ in all that his majesty. We may ask the question, how can dying on the cross in such weakness ever be majestic? The world may see the death of Christ on the cross as defeat and loss, whereas the Son of God died in splendor and majesty. It is majestic because it is the perfect sacrifice. What humankind will not do, the Son of God accomplished to live a sin-free life and die as an atonement of sin to the world, for the world. It is the perfect expression of love of Christ for his children. This is true love. Where we are yet in our sin, Christ died for us. It is a total and final solution to the problem of sin. Sin was dealt with once and for all on the cross. Christ wiped out a note of debt. What kind of debt did Christ cancel? He canceled our spiritual debt, our sins, our transgressions of God's law. And this is what the note of debt refers to. In his crucifixion, Christ symbolically nailed our note of debt to his cross because his sacrifice paid for our debt. It is an ultimate victory over Satan, sin, and death. Satan was disarmed on the cross and put to open shame. We are no longer a slave to sin, but we have been adopted as children of God, amen, part of God's family and love. Amen? Amen? It is an ultimate and supreme example of forgiveness. We are washed clean as white as snow, and we are now clothed with the righteousness of God. Through his sacrifice, there is peace between God and man. And now we can have relationship with what? With the Almighty God. A great price was paid, as it says in 1 Corinthians 6:20. For you were bought with a price. It is this victory that is so majestic on the cross. The second example is the shining example. As we remember what Christ did and achieved on the cross, it also reminds us how we ought to be as children of God. When the light of Christ shines from the cross into the very depth of our heart, it shows us how we ought to live as children of the living God. You know, it is an ultimate example for mankind because on the cross, Jesus died, but then he was alive again. As Christians, we are ought to die to sin and live to righteousness. Dead to old world and living to the kingdom of God. Are we willing to die for others? By this, what do I mean? Putting others before us. Putting the needs of others before us. Materials, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Can you swallow your pride to share the gospel with someone? Christ walked in all humanity. in order to do the will of the Father? Can you sacrifice your time to be with someone, to listen to them, or to spend time to pray for someone as Christ did for us? Jesus always had time for someone who was in need. Are you willing to forgive others, those who have made you, those who have made your life miserable and hated you and bullied you, just as Christ forgave us? You know, brothers and sisters, Christ always prayed for the forgiveness of all those who persecuted him because they did not know what they were doing. Are you willing to love those who hate you and talk bad about you? Christ came to die for the world. While we were yet sinners, you know, Christ died for us. Don't seek the peace of the world, because when you see Christ on the cross, he has purchased peace that passes all understanding for you. Don't seek the love of the world. Look to the cross to see the immeasurable love that Christ poured out for you, that you might be washed clean of your sins and be part of the family of the living God. This is the wonder of the cross. May we be overwhelmed by what Christ has purchased for us on the cross, that we may always stand in wonder for his amazing grace. As we do that, may we become the hand and feet of Jesus Christ, being a light to the world and declare of the good news of the gospel to the world that desperately need it. All this is only possible through the Holy Spirit who now dwells in us. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this evening. We just want to pray for forgiveness, Father. We want to pray for the Holy Spirit to come into us, Father God, so that we can look to others with love. We can look for those who persecute us with love, just as you did for us, Father. You never chose us, you know. You never separated us, like this is good, this is bad. But you looked for us with love, Father. God, we come before you this evening. We want to pray for that spirit that can come into our heart so that we can just share this love that you gave us on the cross, Father God. Thank you, Father, for your Son who died for us on the cross for the forgiveness of our sin. May we carry on this love to us, to the world, Father. God, I pray for the wine. I pray for the bread that symbolizes your body. I pray for the wine that symbolizes your blood that was shed on the cross for the forgiveness of sin. Bless it, Father, and may you take it with a clean heart. I love you, God, and I pray this, trusting and believing through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Throw me deeper.
Today, let's all stand up.
Against the fall, I'll take refuge in you. them articulately, you know, explained all the good things, a few things, of course. We had some of us escape COVID, right, Stellarty? Escaped COVID. We had, of course, our first Men's Day. So there's a lot to be grateful for, but 2020, 2021, 2022 is over, it's behind us. But we do not know what 2023 holds, but we look forward to an incredible time. And if you see the last week in Dubai, it looks like people have been held up for so long and now they're free. How many of you got to see the fireworks? Okay, all of you suffer from FOMO. No, I'm kidding. Fear of missing out. You know, you don't want to miss out on. But every year is the same for me, you know. But some of us are new for this. But honestly, the whole idea is to celebrate, isn't it? But I love the last week between Christmas and the New Year, that 1 week. I love it. Because it gives you a chance to be able to have a perspective, to look at the whole year, to be able to, in a sense, revitalize, refocus, and get ready for the next year.
That's right.
So I hope we all manage to do that. I hope we are ready for 2023. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, it's already taken off. So we are on board. So let me tell you a story. The story is about four IIT students. Okay, you heard of IIT? IIT is one of the premier institutions in India where they have sent out students. They now lead most of the big companies in the world. I mean, whether it's Pepsi or whether it's Google, all the heads are from IIT. Okay, you'll get an idea. So these four IIT students who always thought the best of themselves, they were not prepared for a particular exam. They played cards the whole night. And they realized the next morning, they got up late, they were not ready for the exam, and they missed the exams. So they came to the dean and they said, sir, of course they prepared themselves, said, sir, we were at a friend's wedding, we had a tire burst, and they definitely made themselves look even dirty to come up to the dean. And the dean, of course, took in all of their excuses and said, it's okay, sir, it's okay, guys. You can give the exam in another 3 days. These guys were fired up. They came for the day, third day of the exam, or rather after the third day, they came for the exams, and the exam was a special exam, just two questions. All of them were made to sit in separate classrooms. You know where I'm going with this. You can be an IIT student, but the first question was, which tire burst? They have to only tick mark, four options. Front left, front right, back left, back right. Second question, where were you four sitting? Who was driving, who was on the left front, who was on the left back, and who was on the right? And the scoring would be such that only if all of you had the same answer, would you be able to pass this exam. Sometimes we think we're smart, but there's somebody smarter than us, yeah? Just round the corner. Let's go to God. Father, what a joy to be able to come to you, to worship you on the first day of the year. To know, God, that your grace is incredibly upon us. Father, to know that we've been through much, and yet sometimes, as the Bible says, we are creatures of forgetfulness, and Father, we don't even remember sometimes where we are heading for. Thank you so much that you instituted communion, that you would allow us to remember the death, the burial, and the resurrection. You will allow us to remember the love that stretches forth on the cross. You will allow us, God, to be able to restart ourselves year to year. And Lord, we do not know what this year ahead of us holds for us. But we are coming here with complete hope. But Lord, help us, God, to know that all of this is possible, just like the Ukrainian brother said, is because you are in control. There are people who do not know you will live in this world. And I know, God, that there is also a lot who live with fear, insecurity. A lot of things, God, sometimes we don't face because we know you. Lead us through your spirit. Lead us through your wisdom. Lead us through your understanding. Lead us every single day. Lord, help us even as different parts of the church, the old, the young, help us, God, to be united because of the blood of Christ. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
You know, our theme for the year is... It's connection. So if you are here and you don't have a magnet, you can ask one of the sisters. Okay, there's a magnet like every year. We need to thank Cliff and Rowi for having the magnet designed for us. And you know, when this design came out, there was a whole lot of controversy. There were some people who didn't like the picture of the bees up there. And I thought, okay, let me just share a little bit about the bees. You know, in the Christian tradition, according to Julian, the bee is the emblem of Christ. And you go, why, how is that? Have you not come across a verse that says, sweeter than the honey in the honeycomb is he? Sweeter than the honey in the honeycomb is he? I mean, that was a kingdom song that I used to sing when I was in the Sunday school. But it also, you know, there's another place where the bees are there. When Samson killed somebody, that particular carcass had full of bees. And it actually represented the victory that comes from God and God alone. In the book of Judges, we have the guy, the amazing judge called Deborah. Deborah simply means what? A bee? A bee? Deborah. Deborah is the original name. It simply means a bee. Now, why am I saying all this? I'm just saying that, hey, there's everything in this creation that we can learn from. And these bees are amazing. They have a whole lot of things. They're one of the, by the way, one of the most intelligent creatures that is created. They can memorize your face. They can memorize the same flower that they've been to. They can memorize a lot of things, which is amazing by itself. But get this, there are some more reasons why bees are important. They help produce 1/3 of the world's crops. Yeah. 1/3 of the world's crops. They are also the providers of world's fibers, world's oils, and other raw materials. Figure that out. Medicines, I mean, they create more medicines than any other creature in the world. They provide food for the wildlife. They're good for soil erosion. I can go on and on. Do your Google thing. And we're not going to have a lesson on bees today. I'm just saying, hey, if we can learn from them. I mean, you try going to one of them and you know, attacking a hive, you will find the entire army come against you. And you know, many of them, once they sting, they don't live anymore.
Yeah.
They know that. And still they will protect with the end of their life. So if we can learn from them, then so be it. So we are in 2023. We've gone through 2020, 2021, 2022. I remember end of 19 and beginning of 20, we just heard about COVID a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Remember, we just heard a little bit about it and we're like, we had no idea what the next 3 years is gonna bring. And similarly, we have no idea what the next few years is gonna bring. So how many of us would really take a chance to be able to go out there and say everything is going to be perfect? Because there is nothing that is perfect.
That's right.
But you know what? As a church, we need to look forward. We need to be able to know. By the way, connection is the theme. And the idea is to be able to create a culture of connection. Okay? To be able to, now that's the beast. Some people don't like to see that. But we need to have a culture of connection. Many of us have become disconnected one from the other. We, before COVID and after COVID, have become equal to BC and AD, by the way. We have so many distractions today, so many, that it's not difficult for us to get disconnected. You know, there are marriages, you know, they've talked about as many as, I don't know, about 1/3 more than normal divorces just during COVID. Why? I don't know. I mean, you should have gone closer, right? When you got the time. But no, people actually got on each other's nerves. We have become disconnected, perhaps, with our own makers. With our maker. You know, to connect with the Almighty God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, to connect with people around us, in our families, in our homes, in our neighborhoods, and then to connect people with the Lord are some things we will learn through the whole year. But today my lesson is simply called connectability. The ability to connect. For us to be able to know that each of us can connect, but we need to learn what it means to be able to be prepared for that. So, and we need an intentional approach to connect. You walk into a room, it is not easy to go and connect with everyone, yeah? Aaron is a brother who became a disciple in Goa. He works in Nepal, and you know, he's come here for the first time, and he came and sat there, and I said, hey, You may want to go and say hi to people. So I said, go ahead, meet, and he met one or two, and of course then came back and said, again. Then as soon as Jomar walked in, I said, Jomar leads the singles, get to meet him. And then ask Jomar, please go ahead and take him around. Because, you know, it's not easy to come into a group which is, you know, completely strangers. Of course, he knows that many of you are disciples. But to be able to connect with you, it takes a lot to be able to go out of yourself. Wouldn't you say that?
Yes.
Those of us who are introverts, we know exactly what that means. Yeah, we come into a room and we would rather be in the darkest part of the room. We do not want anything to do with anything. But, you know, it's the ability to connect is something that we need to have an intentional approach with.
Yeah.
My encouragement today for us, from our sermon today, is to be able to learn to connect with ourselves first. To be able to know where we come from. Some of the questions we need to ask is, where have I reached in my Christian life? I mean, I could ask you how many years you've been in the church, but that's different from where have I reached in my Christian walk? Where am I today in my joys, in my failures, in my understanding of life around me? Where am I vis-a-vis leaning on a God who is so much there for us, but how much of it am I connected with? Where am I mean, I could go on, isn't it? Where am I grateful with? What am I grateful with? Am I really grateful or not? Do I have those blessings that I'm counting on a daily basis? Or do I forget things pretty easy? You know, we are pilgrims, by the way, traveling on a road, every day needing God's mercies.
Yeah, that's right.
To keep us and to help us all along the way. How many of you heard of John Bunyan? I mean, in India, of course, we have it in our studies, isn't it? The Pilgrim's Progress. He lived in the 1600s. He wrote this incredibly classic Christian allegory. Now, this describes the trials and triumphs of a Christian. You know, this particular protagonist called Christian. And the guy travels from the city of destruction to the celestial city. Okay? In that journey, he goes through the slough of despond, which means, you know, you're low in spirits because you have no more hope. Despondency. Then he passes through the house of Mr. Legality, which means he learns how to go through things just for the lip service, but not really his heart being involved. He also goes to the Valley of Humiliation, where he becomes a laughing stock. And then he fights Satan, Apollyon. And after which he is captured in the Vanity Fair, which is because of his pride. And later he was imprisoned by despair in the Doubting Castle, because he was completely not sure if he was heading the right way. He escaped, of course, using the key called promise. And then he crosses the river of mortality to be able to come to the celestial city. Now that, in some ways, you know, it sounds a little bit too high, right? How many of us really got any of this? Okay, some of you are smart. But, you know, it's not easy to see. You read this book, it's a book on literature, because of how deep that understanding needs to be of being able to understand the human characterizations and how we go through all kinds of stages in our life. And so I would like to highlight a few of them today. Keeping up with this language, I'm going to talk about the atrium of amnesia. How many of you know what is amnesia? Amnesia means forgetfulness. Sometimes we forget that we are supposed to pass the plate. So after the prayer, we get up slowly and we go out and pick up the plate. At my age, that happens quite often, by the way. Believe me, yesterday we were playing Pictionary in the night, and I knew that my wife drew this picture of a dress that the women wear, and I bought for her. I know the name, I know what it is, but I can't get the name. Has that happened to you?
Yeah.
You want to recollect something and you just can't get the name. I don't know if it is old age catching up, or is it just like Google, you know, your memory power is full. You know, it's time to delete a few things. We have too many things in our brains, by the way, as of now. The atrium of amnesia. You know, amazingly, inside this huge shopping mall, people are on the move always. These are the FOMO people, of course. Acquiring all the good things in life. They don't want to miss out on anything. All right, they are so busy doing this that they have completely forgotten that they were pilgrims on a journey to the celestial city. All right, the sight of endless rows of shops filled with amazing goodies, filled with amazing ideas, gadgets. It's a strong smell, spell, and causes forgetfulness. You know, the role of honor in this shopping mall is King Solomon, one of the guys who had everything, but he forgot where he was headed for. There's another guy called Demas. Remember Demas? The departing Demas? Who was there right through the beginning of that missionary journey with Paul, but when things got rough, that's it. You saw the last of Demas. But to ensure that faithful pilgrims, like you and me, like brothers and sisters, who want to really be able to go on to their relationship with God, go on in their relationship with God, the Bible says, God puts up this particular warning. When the Lord your God brings you into the land he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you a land with large flourishing cities which you did not build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you did not provide, wells that you did not dig, vineyards and olive groves you did not plant, then when you eat and you are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Brothers and sisters, forgetfulness is absolutely a dangerous weakness. We forget where we come from, as it says in the book of 1 Corinthians. We forget who we were before. We forget what kind of a mess we were in. And sometimes we want, just like a dog returns from his vomit, the Bible says, we want to go back to sometimes the sin we left behind. But we could be, because in this particular atrium, and as we become busier in our careers, we actually forget the need for a connection with our God. Now, we sometimes forget. You know, there's a brother who is to head Ralph Lauren all over India. When we were reaching out to him, he wasn't even open. He came, he would sit, he would really not mix up with anybody in the church. He did not allow his wife to become a disciple. And then one fine day, he had a stroke. And that's it. And he was around in his early 50s at the time. And that's it. He has no more memories. He's like a walking vegetable, literally. He remembers a few things, but every day he has to be reminded, this is your wife, this is your daughter. He has walked out of home a couple of times. Even as we speak, he's in the ICU, fighting for his life. Or rather, he's in coma, he's not even fighting. There are people of your age and my age, even at this point, who's probably fighting with death, or fighting with something that they despair about. They want to be at the end of a noose, perhaps. But you know, we sometimes, in that celebration of everything, we forget where God's grace has been sufficient for us. We become so deeply engrossed that we forget the Lord and all the precious lessons that we have learned from Him. And for this reason, the Bible says, my son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart. Keep my commands in your heart. We hear 52 sermons. I always say this. In a year. That is if you come every week. Or you catch up on that because of your work scenario. And how much of that sermon, I mean, if we read our Bible every day, that's at least one chapter we read every day. How much of that retains with us? Or does that come in through one part of our ears and then go out? How can we avoid this pitfall? Firstly, the Bible says, when you've eaten and you're satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good that He has given you.
Amen.
To develop a heart that is grateful.
Yeah.
Grateful. Just grateful on a daily basis. You know, we could be focusing on a lot of things in our life. Just try this one area for this year. Being grateful for where we are today. Amen. Secondly, we must pay careful attention, the Bible says, to what we have heard and do not drift away. Sadly, if we do not review the precious truths. You know, we take down notes. I hope we are taking down notes. I hope we have some way to connect, or at least we go back to, you know, the online scenario and we have a recording to catch up with. But right now, maybe one thing you want to take away from a lesson that you've learned. One thing in your midweek, one thing in your fellowship with someone else. Because these are all value that gets added to your values of your life. That becomes your part of your foundation. It will allow you to be able to become an overcomer. Because if we are not cutting down a lot of these things, please be careful that we are probably slipping into the atrium of amnesia. Secondly, the station of stagnation. You know, you'll find in this particular station, one of the persons you'll find is me. You see, in our journey, please do not get off at this railway station. Because once you get off, it is not easy to get on again. Once you've decided to alight from that particular direction, it is not easy. Because people who are at this station are people who are sitting around doing nothing. We need to ask ourselves, how useful have I been in the past few years for my Lord? How have I been involved in being, in the Bible says, in the last days, forceful men will lay hold of the kingdom because the kingdom will be forcefully advancing. Is it really happening with us being involved in that part of the ministry? We need to be able to know that there are people out there who look old enough to eat meat but are still on baby food. They still need the, you know, we live in a time when, you know, I don't have a phone here. You see, most of us, we want to be entertained for the whole time. Mm-hmm. You put somebody in a room, the whole time you want to be entertained with either the reels or with Facebook or with whatever else that we are getting into. And some of us can say, oh, I'm doing that because I'm gaining knowledge. I hope you are. There are parents who understand the value of taking away those gadgets from their children. You don't take that away today. I'm telling you, that disconnect is even more by the time they are ready to fly. Yeah. As of now, they're roosted in your nest. They're there. They're there as long as you want them. But the day you don't have them, they already are connected with something else, and that's not you. Make sure as parents you know that. Stagnation. You know, God has a way of, before you come to the station, just like your metro train, it'll tell you, next stop, stagnation station. Passengers heading for heaven, please do not alight. He'll tell you that. You know, you need to be warned. It says in Hebrews chapter 5. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Therefore, let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from acts that lead to death and of faith in God. You know, the original recipients of this warning were Christians who had stagnated in their own life. And the Lord himself had to tell them through his word, through his spirit, listen, wake up. If you had grown normally by now, you would not only look big, but actually you would have matured to an understanding where you can take care of yourself and take care of a few others spiritually. Let's give a big hand to some of the family group leaders who have tirelessly worked in this past year. And I'll tell you what, we do not have any full-time ministry in this church. We have few people who put up their hands. And when they do put up their hands, they actually are out there being able to serve one another. Some of you don't even realize this, but they are praying for you every day. They're actually reaching out to you. They have their own fires in their own backyard. But they would do that extra bit because they have grown to that point to be able to give and give and give. But let me say, let it not be said that you actually arrived at the celestial city or on judgment day and you have not been a giver. Let it not be said that you've been a taker. Hey, listen, it doesn't matter who you are. You could just cross the road and invite a person. You could just turn around and look at the person sitting in the metro or the bus or even among your colleagues and just say, hey, would you like to come to church? That's all it takes. And then to be able to walk with them, to be able to reach out to young Christians that come, to be able to reach out to people who walk through the door and they are new. And then, no, it's good to be able to say Happy New Year to people we know each other, whom you've already probably wished, but how about people who have not been seen before and they walked in through that door? Yeah. You know, when I walked in through that door 35 years ago, that is what changed me, really. There was a guy at the door, and I've shared this so many times, he gives me a hug. Nobody ever had given me a hug, not even my parents. Because in Indian society, we don't do that. You just give a small thing or you touch their feet. But giving a hug was a new thing. And it was a guy giving me a hug, and I'm like, what are you doing? But you know, when you get into the door, you realize everybody wanted to know you. Everybody wanted to know where you come from. Remember that? People are excited about who you are. It is important to be able to have a heart that is there to give. You know, some of us need to relearn the basic principles of being able to know why we are disciples. Mm-hmm. Because out there, there's a lot of confusion stuff. Yeah. There's a lot of stuff. And let me tell you, the stuff is so confusing that we could even bring it to our quiet time and start having a problem with that. It is important to be able to wrestle that in our walk with God. You know, and I want to encourage us pilgrim brothers and sisters, this very sad state of affairs, when it comes to being able to stagnate, it says we need to decide to grow spiritually until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the entire measure of the fullness of Christ. There is an incredible Lord. You know, as we heard in the communion, there is an incredible Lord who gave us everything he had. Think about it for a minute, okay? Close your eyes and think about it, where he was before he came to be among us. Just think about it. Only from what you've known the scriptures. The Bible says he was seated at the right hand of God. There were angels around him, the seraphim, they were with him. They were serving him. He himself was the Lord and Master of everything that was around. And the Bible says he decided to keep that up. That is fine. It is like a new journey. You decide to go from one place to the other. But then when you arrive at the other place, you realize it's nowhere near heaven. Of course, he knew that. But he was able to come not because anybody pressured him, but because his father loved him and told him, listen, this is the promise I have for you. Or this is the purpose I have for you. And the Bible says he stretched his arms on the cross. Not because of anything. He didn't even know any of us individually. But he chooses to know us. He chooses to love us. He chooses to be able to say, listen, there is a journey that you're part of. Don't stagnate. Don't stay there. The Bible says, if you are not growing in the Lord, you are actually falling away from the Lord. Don't even think twice about that. I'm telling you, I'm dealing with a couple that's going into divorce this week. Probably they've already decided to separate. We told them. There was advice given. But they refused. And today, sadly, their sin continues with them. And they're just married. You go, that can happen out there in the world? Absolutely it can happen. That is the way of it. Now if you're ready for that, choose to be able to be in that stagnation station. Or, because you know, there are some incredible people in this stagnation station and you don't want to be part of their life. Or, this is what Paul had to say. One thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. If Paul could understand that, being a Pharisee among Pharisees, if Paul could understand that in spite of being a persecutor himself and being a murderer, if Paul could understand that he himself was not accepted in the kingdom of God for 1 year plus, till Barnabas came to Tarsus to look for him. If Paul could understand that, it doesn't matter whatever else is happening. I've got to press on because I'm on a journey first to save myself and then to save as many people around me. Are you with me, church?
Yes. Yeah.
You know, this year I was guilty of stagnation, as I said. I'll tell you, more than 50% of the year, I struggled to pray. And I'm not saying I didn't pray. I've been long enough to know that I need to pray. But I struggled. I struggled to grow in a lot of areas. I would share about some of that with brothers. I would share about it in different ways. And then towards the year, I realized, hey, you know, I had no more will to live. There were days when I would think, what more should I do? And you go, but really, Jacob, why didn't you talk about it? Well, I did. Except that people could not realize that all the time. There are people who realize that. There are people who challenge me. But it's a great place that you feel like sorry for yourself, you feel victimized, you feel like, oh, life is not easy. I studied the Bible with a lot of people who just kept rejecting the Word of God. And you go, why is it? Why is it that? And I wouldn't have the courage to go to the next guy to study the Bible. Really, I started struggling and thinking, do I really have the passion to do this? You see, stagnation point starts making you feel, because you're not really doing much. You're out there, you're feeling sorry for yourself, and you can be in a bad place. You know, I struggled and asked for help, but honestly speaking, till a person decides to help himself, no matter who comes into your life, it cannot change anything. The third one, pillar of pride, like the Burj Khalifa. Okay, I mean, Basam told me Abu Dhabi had much more beautiful fireworks than Burj Khalifa fireworks, and I believe him, because there were three world records. There are three world records, one with drones, one with the timing. You know, the book of the Guinness Book of Records, the only second office in the whole world is in Dubai. And I met the guy who was in charge here, and he said, why only Dubai and why only UK? And he goes, well, only Dubai, or rather UAE, has about 40 Guinness Book of Records every year. So instead of traveling 40 times, we decided to set up an office here. Three world records. Okay, beautiful. But you know what? That is not the in and out and of itself. It is not everything. It's not like you missed anything. If you've not, you can catch up on it in YouTube. That's what Basam told me. Go to YouTube, you can catch up on it. But the tallest skyscraper in town, the pillar of pride, is built by similar people who built the Tower of Babel. Because it boasts of having the greatest and the best of everything. It has large convention halls, Amen Kennedy. It has huge displays, fastest lifts. I mean, a friend of mine who came here couldn't believe in 1 minute he had crossed 123 floors and he didn't even have a year block. That's what we have in this country. People love to go to the top, and it was this kind of a height that gave Nebuchadnezzar this idea of what an incredible guy I am. I need to be worshipped. The pillar of pride. Is a time when it's dangerous, of course, because when you enter this tower, you realize the foundations are very weak. It is built upon transient dreams. Dreams that will come and dreams that will float away. Illusory of self-glory, not knowing that like the flower, we're there for a while, as beautiful as it looks, it's one day going to wither. I hate giving flowers to my wife, not for anything else. For many years, for almost 23 years, I never gave a fresh flower. The guy goes, by the third day it's dead, that flower is dead. I would rather give a pot of plant. I would rather give plastic flowers, which I don't do. But I learned 2 years ago, was it 3 years ago, that I have to give flowers. So you do give flowers now. And after I told her, after 3 days the flowers are dead, now all over my house we have dried flowers. It's dried flowers that are all over my place because she's afraid to throw them away. It's like, but you know, men have a different way to think. Men are from Mars, women are from?
Venus.
There you go. You don't understand fully everything, but sometimes love languages have to be understood. But you know what? The pride pinnacle is always a torturing place. It's a place that can cause disaster of immense proportions. And when I say immense, means sometimes we wonder, you know, let's look at this verse, okay? This is what Jesus had to say. So if you think you're standing firm, Paul is telling the church in Corinth, he said, be careful that you don't fall. Be careful that you don't fall. Those of us, what do we take pride in? You know, some of our forms of pride is visible, but some are not so visible. It's there, it's very clandestine, it's very subtle, it's there. There are areas, even in personal achievements and services to the Lord, we can be proud about. I've been in the kingdom for 35 years. Guess what? 36th year could be your doom. Satan got Solomon. Satan got so many. Don't even be proud about being the longevity. We could be feeling good about being good and humble and having faith, but be careful. Pride comes before a fall. And the Bible says, God brings judgment on everybody who's full of pride. Look in Isaiah, look in Proverbs. I mean, and knowing how much God hates pride, we need to do everything we can to put it away. And pride and ego and all the other cousins, I mean, Watch out for that. Oh, but I already said it, so now you need to do it. No, 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 it has nothing to do with you. God has already spoken. Let God's Spirit lead us. Some of us feel, if I'm humble, people will walk over me. And that's true. People who stay humble will tell you that there are too many people walking over them. But being meek is not being weak.
Yeah.
Get this. It is not a sign of weakness. It's only the strong who can be meek. You know, you cannot deal with this particular pillar till you realize it's your problem.
Yeah.
Finally, the Hall of Hypocrisy. This is an incredibly large clubhouse where people love to rub shoulders with people of their own kind, the elite, okay? But there's one peculiarity with this. Everybody who comes to this clubhouse, the Hall of Hypocrisy, they all wear masks. So you are not even seeing the real person, because that's a hypocrite and so are we, and then a hypocrite means a hypocrite. And before we know, we do not really know anybody. There is no connection whatsoever. And not that we care about the connection. And you know, the people who are in this Hall of Hypocrisy are descendants of the time when Jesus challenged them. He says, be on your guard against what? Against the east of the Pharisee, which is hypocrisy. You know, this is a dangerous pitfall, especially for mature disciples. We could probably have to look deep enough to realize when we were young and in faith, we had more freedom, more excitement, more ability to learn, more ability to ask, more ability to serve, more ability to take challenges, more ability to give. We were at that point till we have now reached a point where we think we know all. I'm here now to tell everybody else what they need to do. You know, it's a sad place to be in. The Bible says these people honor me with their lips. They come to church, but their hearts, they are far from me. Brothers and sisters, let's not be a shareholder in the hall of hypocrisy. Let's watch out for this hypocrisy, where we switch on Christianity when we meet each other, and we switch it off. Okay, we probably with that Pharisee who fasted and who prayed and who gave his tithe and everything, and the Lord says you've been rejected. But that guy who's a sinner, who's out there praying, he's the one who's accepted. Let's watch out for the hall of hypocrisy. You know, how to avoid this? By the way, anybody who is a hypocrite needs to be judged, the Bible says. But in the hall of hypocrisy, we've got to understand a couple of things. All a person's ways seem pure to them, but the motives are weighed by the Lord. A person may think their own ways are right, but the Lord weighs the heart. Most of us have no idea what a heart is going through, what a heart is decided, what a heart is heading toward. But we can gain wisdom from God's understanding. We need to ask ourselves, why am I doing what I'm doing? I've entered 2023. I want to be connected with God. I want to be connected to the people. I want to become a person that can connect people with God. But how can I be able to change my ways? Brothers and sisters, we've got to exercise diligence to avoid each of these four. Let's have Bina come and share.
I know it's been a heavy message. Good evening, everyone, and a very happy new year to all my dear brothers and sisters and all who have come here. I think he was talking about the different phases of life, and I think something I was just, thinking about my Christian journey, as a disciple, to just talk about a little bit, in the few minutes. So it gives an idea of, for me it was like reflecting on things of my Christian life. So it's like I think since you already know the points, you'll understand, how the flow is. It's like I became a disciple in 1993, and it was a beautiful thing that happened to me in my life, because there were a lot of things. That's another story by itself, a whole, sharing by itself. And I was working as a junior engineer in IFB Bosch at that time. And Immediately, within a few months, I was called to be a Bible talk leader, a zone leader, a sector leader. And by 1994, I was asked to be in the full-time ministry. And 1995, I moved to another city. I got married. And the same year, 1995, I was appointed as a women's ministry leader. In 1996, I had my first son, Suraj. So talk about it, you know. It was like a great, it was full of God's blessings, and it was going, and it's like, and you know, somehow, when you keep going, that all the blessings come, you forget, you know, as we heard about in the first point, you know, hey, who is the one who's getting it? You know, the glory suddenly becomes yours. Mm-hmm. It's like, hey, you know, I'm doing it. It's mine. And soon, I think it was like, even about the churches, it was like we were leading, when we started off like 100 plus, then it was like we moved to another region, which was 400 plus, then we moved to Delhi, which was like almost 600 plus disciples, and it was like, you know, so it was like, it was, we enjoyed, no doubt, we both of us love ministry. So it was like, but the heart behind that, it was like a lot of things, it was about yourself. And God knows us well, and God loves us enough to the point, so when we were in Delhi, you know, it was our marriage was not doing well. So in a way, it was God's blessing. You know, it's like when you go in yours, you know, it is all about me. It's about, you know, the pride comes in. And then we were asked to step down from being regional leaders and come back to a city to get the help. I think that was like, wow, really humbling, really, really, it's like we cried and we were like, couldn't come in terms with, because for me, I've never faced failures. You know, as a student also is always getting, you know, good grades, topping, and you know, same thing was going on in the ministry life. So it's like, oh, this is how it is. And suddenly, boom, and it was like, couldn't accept it. And well, I think that was the point that I said, wow, God is dealing with my heart. Okay, I became a disciple, but my heart was never really, you know, dealt with the pain of the change, you know, being humble and being taught. And then we come, you know, we got in terms with it years, and thank God, you know, we got the help that we needed. And I reached a point that I think we, both of us, reached a point of stagnation. It's like, you know, when you're a disciple and you need to, you know, when you don't grow, you feel stuck. It's like, you know, there is no more growth. There is, you know, it is like, what more to do? It is like you're stagnated. And I think that was around the time we decided, we chose, we prayed a lot and decided to leave the full-time ministry. And I don't know if it was the right decision, but we were like at that point. And I think that's how we ended up landing in Dubai in 2004. And since then, it has been a beautiful journey. And many of you have known us since then. I think have seen us, you know, struggle to come in terms of even taking any responsibilities and start. I think many 5 years down the lane, we decided to lead a Bible talk. You know, and it was not something, but God had to, you know, help us. But I think the beautiful thing that happened was, for me, even though I was in the full-time ministry, I think I felt a lot of things, you know, kind of got stuck. But getting in back into the corporate world, working there, gave me a total another perspective of life. Challenges what people go through in their day-to-day life. Challenges, temptations, struggles, what things we go on. And I was like, wow, this is a different phase of life. You know, it's like, and it was quite humbling. You know, I was reporting to someone who was like much younger to me, and it was like not, and here you're like, you know, we're leading thousands of people, but that was quite humbling. And at the same time, it kind of, I felt I was growing. It felt like, hey, another path. This is what, so you know, God loved, and I'm very thankful because it helped me. Okay, even wherever we are, it is, hey, through all this, one thing is a constant factor, and that is what I love the theme about this year, connection. I think it was the connection with God. I think everything else around you can fail, but your connection with God is the only thing that will stay, you know, forever. And I think that's one constant. That, when I was a young Christian, so, you know, this was an illustration that was taught to me. I don't know if it was taught to many of you probably. It is like a house with a bulb and a switch. You know, it's like the analogy is about your Christian life and your relationship with God. I said, okay, you have a switch here, you put it on, and the light glows. You know, and the diagram is like, how did that happen? But there is a connection that is happening between the switch and the light. Otherwise, the light will not glow. I said, okay, this is how your Christian life is. And it, you know, it's taught to me. There is a God, and here you are. But if your faith has to be, you know, translated into deeds, that connection needs to happen. So the only source is God. The only source that can transform our behavior, our character, everything is only God, the source. So the connection is so important. You know, it's talking about the main switch, you know, the house has a main switch and a lot of other small switches, you know, which switch which has the, you know, high power probably to the refrigerator or something. Those can be switched off, but if a main switch is switched off, everything is off. That's how our connections is very important, is important. Maybe it's friends, families, other relationship, but there is a main connection, the source that comes. If that is turned off, I think everything else will be darkness. I think that's what I learned through the whole, you know, journey. Hey, different points, I think we are faced where we hit a wall, but we know that it is only through the God who is our main source. And if you're connected, I think that's the theme, you know, the first phase of our, like, you know, there are a lot of other connections through the year we'll be talking about. I think if only if we can reflect, you know, where are we at today? And I think many of you sisters, there's something that I would like to encourage you as well. Take out time, you know, because this is so important, you know, to look where are we at today with our connection with our God, with our Creator. So if only if that can be sorted out, I think we can go through this, you know, all these different stages. And of course, the life would be something more beautiful. Amen. Thank you.
You know, I have a simple challenge for each one of us. It is important to be able to not allow this to just pass by. I encourage you to this week, you know, if you can, possibly connect with your mentor, with your discipling partner, with your spouse, or whoever you feel connected with already. You know, talk about the area that one focus that you want in your connectability with God. In, you know, one of these four areas that you want to watch out for. Talk to the areas where, you know, talk about if at all there's a hindrance, how to deal with that hindrance. What do I need to do? Because, you know, getting into 2023 is an incredible thing.
Yeah.
Would you agree?
Yeah.
We are here today. Many of our friends, neighbors are not even with us in this year. But even as we enter this year, let's put our best foot forward. Let's know that there's an incredibly amazing God who walks with us. He carries us through our difficult times. He's right there to help us, train us, teach us through even Balaam's donkey. But when he is there, you have nothing to fear. And when we actually come through on that day, to that celestial city, you cross the river of mortality, let me tell you, it's going to be worth it, and we can give God the glory. Amen.
Good evening, everyone, and Happy New Year again. It's indeed a fitting sermon we heard today from Jacob. It's like, you know, when we're doing our New Year's resolution, sort of. These are what we call red flags. And we all know truth hurts, right? So at the beginning of the year, we're always listing up what our goals and our plans or what we're supposed to do for this year, right? And adding to that importance of connection and being connected, it's like we're supposed to build, right? You know, a dwelling place for God. And if we are losing zeal or enthusiasm, how can we grow and bear good fruits, right? And that's where we're supposed to be, you know, that's one of our goals, right? And it make us, you know, have that clear vision of looking looking ahead for that eternal inheritance that we are all desired, right? So this one is a, as I've said, a fitting message for this year, and I will have my wife to add more sharing.
First of all, thank you, Arthur and Nikki, for the great warm welcome. Thank you, Nash, for sharing the goodness of our Lord. It reminds us the unconditional love of Christ through the sacrifice He did on the cross and the impact it made for us to change in accordance to His teachings. Thank you, Jacob, for the message. It's a good way to start the year with the message to inspire us and make us to refocus and be more prepared for what is in store in this year. But what I can take home from the message is we have to assess ourselves with our connection with God, our focus, our priorities. Let us not forget what God has done for us and all that He is still doing for us. It reminds us also to have a grateful heart, go out of our comfort zone, grow in our faith, in our spirituality, and let us serve to give glory to God. Lastly, don't let pride and hypocrisy hinder us to connect to God and to others.
Amen. So thank you everyone who have been part of this great service. And as we close our worship service, I would just like to mention some few announcements. Please note that those who missed this live worship service, there will be a recording on our ICOC YouTube channel, so you just look on that probably in a few hours or tomorrow. For the next worship service, we'll be back here, same hall at 4 p.m. and then try to, you know, invite people, those who are, you know, trying to, you know, search for Christ and God, so we can grow more as a family. So for next week, we also have this leaders meeting. That will be at 2 p.m. on room 307, right, of the Vision Hall. And also, we would like to encourage, you know, everyone. We have a midweek meetings for all the Emirates, so just go on with your friends who have invited you today that for further details like the timings and locations. Kids Kingdom, we will be having it by next Sunday. So we encourage parents to be part of this program and just approach Cliff and Robbie if you want to volunteer for this year. Monthly contributions can be handed over to your finance representative or family group leaders. And lastly, let's continue to pray, of course, for each other and for everything that will be fine, and the peace that we're praying for those who are now in suffering of war, okay? So that concludes our worship service. Let's go to God in prayer. Almighty Father, we're so blessed and grateful that gave us this opportunity to worship you, Lord. And we pray that for the next 364 days, we will be healthier, both physically and spiritually. We'll be wiser in our decisions, Lord, and whatever goals, plans that we are listed for this year, may it all be fulfilled for all your glory, Lord. Again, we thank you. We love you. Just be with us as we depart from this place. And all these I pray to you, Lord. Amen.
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 Amen. Thanks so much everyone for coming. Let's all stand up and sing our final song.
Lift your voice, it's a hero to believe.